Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the 2012 Giannini Foundation of Agricultural Economics lecture. My name is Colin Carter. I'm the director of the Giannini Foundation of Agricultural Economics. I would like to begin by thanking Julie McNamara for doing all the organization for this event. Thank you so much, Julie. And we are very privileged today to have with us Professor Esther Duflo from MIT. Esther, thank you so much for taking time from your busy schedule. Esther's a new mother, and it's always difficult to travel, especially when you have children, and we really do appreciate you taking time to spend with us here in Davis and Berkeley. Esther Duflo is the founding director of the Abdul Latif Jameel Poverty Action Lab at MIT, known as JPAL. This is a major accomplishment that she has pulled off. She has set up and funded a unique global research network that's already making a difference with the world's poor. I commend her for that. Esther was the 2010 John Bates Clark Medal winner, the very prestigious award by the American Economic Association. Last year, Professor Duflo's book, Poor Economics, with Abhijit Banerjee, won the Financial Times and Goldman Sachs Business Book of the Year Award. The Economist magazine recently listed Professor Duflo as one of the top 8 young economists in the world. In April 2011, Esther Duflo was named one of Time magazine's 100 most influential people in the world. Esther Duflo is clearly a leading intellectual in the economics profession, and her work is having broad social impacts. When I mentioned to one of my colleagues that I was inviting Esther to give the 2012 Giannini lecture, my colleague was very pessimistic about the odds of someone as busy and as important as Esther accepting. A few weeks later, I sent out an email after I did a high five saying, Esther has accepted. And my friend said, well, how did you do it? And I said, well, I had a little bit of hope. Professor Duflo's lecture today is on the economics of hope, lack of hope, and the persistence of poverty. Welcome, Esther.
Good afternoon. I'm going to move this. I'm very short, so this lectern would hide me almost completely. So thank you very much. First, I'm deeply honored and appreciative that I get to give this lecture today, and it was fun and instructive to meet students and faculty during the day. Colin mentioned that rather than one specific research paper, it would be interesting to have a broader talk. And at the same time, I get a little bit bored with campaign pitch would be the appropriate term right now, about why one needs to do experiments and all that. I also thought it would maybe not be all that useful in a place like here, since agricultural economists have been doing experiments before I was born, and so there was not really much to discuss here. So I thought I could have a general talk that would be about an issue of substance, which is trying to put together a strand of various people's work and extract one lesson, not on one sector like education or agriculture or technology or health, but maybe bringing across sector of what from a number of studies that have accumulated over the years and we have learned so far about the effect of hope, or lack thereof really, on poverty and living poverty, and what remains to be learned. As you will see in several places, a lot of the work that I'm going to talk about today, or a lot of the ideas I'm going to put forward, I don't think are fully tested, and they might be wrong. So don't take this as like, this is the state of the, you know, this is like the world of truth coming out of my mouth, but rather maybe a chance to think where I see a lot of potentially interesting work to be done in the future, which might be of interest for those of you who are graduate students and looking for things to do. So let me give you some little one piece of introduction, starting with a story, not an anecdote, but a story about a particular program. BRAC, a lot of you might know about, is sort of the other big Bangladeshi MFI, the non-Grameen part of a big Bangladeshi MFI. And contrary to Grameen, a little bit differently from Grameen, they have an NGO aspect to what they do. So they do a lot of activities that are non-profit and that are not really designed to be financially sustainable ever. And one of these is the program that they call the Ultra Poor Program, which works roughly like that. The targets are for people who are too poor to become clients of BRAC microfinance wing. So they are people who the credit officer at BRAC deem not credit worthy, or don't have a project, or don't have manpower to actually run, do something. So a lot of single-headed household, older women or younger women or people who have been abandoned or things like that. And the program works roughly as follows. They transfer one asset, which could be a pair of cows or four goats or a sewing machine and some like cloth. And then they give people a stipend for a few weeks after the asset transfer. So in part, so they are not tempted to dispose of the asset immediately. That gives some liquidity. And there is also a lot of hand-holding. There is weekly meetings, a little bit like the microcredit meetings happen weekly. So here the women meet weekly, not to reimburse, they have nothing to reimburse, but to discuss stuff, how things are going. They get a lot of support to take care of the assets, so the cows are immunized and things like that. There is also a mandatory savings component. So it's a kind of a joint package of a program. And what's interesting about it, many things are interesting about it, but it's been evaluated in lots of countries. I think there are about 8 countries that are part of the experiment now, run by different research groups, and almost always run by different groups as well. So it's copies of it that are being done in Yemen, in Haiti, and in Bangladesh, in India, two experiments, etc. And we're starting to get the results of those follow-up. And what I'm going to talk about today is just one of them, which are the results for West Bengal, where it was implemented with an organization called Bandhan, which is a very big microfinance organization, the biggest microfinance organization in India at the moment, and which is very much inspired by BRAC. So we were involved, Abhijit Banerjee, Jesse Shapiro, Raghav Chakrapadayana, in the evaluation of the program in West Bengal. So it's a very simple-minded evaluation. People were randomly assigned at the individual level to the program, and then people who got it, who wanted it, got it, and then we are comparing treated and untreated people. What we find, we have now two waves of a survey, one which is roughly a year after the asset was distributed, and one which was a year after the program was ended. So when people really have no direct relationship with the program anymore. Some of them still have a relationship with Bandhan because they graduate into becoming microfinance clients. And what we found is an increase in consumption of 15% after a year, which persisted a year later. So a very persistent increase in consumption. So if you accumulate that over the lifetime of the project, that's much bigger of the value of the asset, and even if you account for some rate of interest at which the asset would have given. It's also the case that there is increases in various sources of income, not just the income that are directly related to the asset. So for example, people who got cows, you do see increase in milk products and sales of animal products, but you also do see increase, particularly in the second year, in income coming from businesses that are non-agricultural. So So what you see in particular in the second year is people starting, who got the cows, being more likely to start a little shop or being more likely to start a little like sewing business or something like that. And the businesses have expanded even more after 1 year than immediately after. So what seemed to have happened, or one possible interpretation, is the program seemed to have unlocked some kind of poverty trap where people kind of got going into a dynamic where they continue making more money, not only from the program, but from various sources. So where does the poverty trap come from? So as you probably, a lot of you know, the source of poverty trap has to be over a range, a very steep relationship between income today and income in the future. What's important is this notion, very steep. Or it could be a step. It could be that, a double-sided relationship between income today and income tomorrow is not sufficient to generate a poverty trap. It has to be quite steep, such that it intersects the 45-degree line from below at some point. So if that is the case, then over a range, when people are poor, over time, they become poorer and poorer, while above a threshold, they enter a zone where we are in a much more classical case of diminishing return, where people who are poorer within this range have higher return, and therefore they are getting richer, progressing faster than the richer people, and therefore they end up into an equilibrium to the right, on the right side. So the classical example of poverty traps that probably a lot of you know about is the nutrition-based poverty trap. So that's based on this idea that there is a minimal number of calories needed to sustain the body, maybe, 1,000 calories or 1,200. So if you eat fewer than this minimum amount, you're too weak to do any meaningful work. So you might not die, but you might just like kind of sitting around doing not much. And therefore, you will not be able to earn enough food to eat even that many calories. And therefore, you will become poorer and poorer until you just sit there and wait. Above some threshold, if you can get enough calories above that threshold, the body becomes fully functional, and then you get the usual diminishing return to extra calories, potentially going back down to even a declining return after some time. So that's the classical example of a poverty trap. But of course, there are many other possibilities of poverty traps. You could have poverty traps, for example, for small businesses that you could even have more than one where there are a number of thresholds where growing the business a little bit becomes impossible past some certain point. For example, many of the businesses in developing countries have zero employee. So it's just the owner who is kind of running little shop or is sewing, has a single sewing machine. So they can absorb so much capital. After a while, once their house is full of goods, there is no space anymore, so they would need to increase the business, not by a little bit, but by a lot for it to be worthwhile. So maybe hire an extra employee, for example, get some extra space. So you wouldn't do that without doing it at some scale. So, and maybe you would then become more productive. So there would be a jump to cross. That also generates poverty traps or multiple steady states, which are generally interpreted as poverty traps, which is the notion where you start from might end up when you end up, unless someone is prepared to lend you a lot of money so that you can borrow enough to jump across the threshold. Otherwise, you'll end up at a low threshold. So if we think about the notion of the ultra-poor program in the context of this poverty trap argument, we can ask, well, where is it coming? Where would it be coming from? How is it that we are seeing people, what has allowed this program to launch into a dynamic? Now, the way the experiment was constructed doesn't really allow us to answer this question very in a definitive way. Maybe we can do more in terms of putting more assumptions, but there is just one treatment where some people got the program and some people didn't, and hence this whole package, I don't think we can be fully sure of exactly the mechanism at hand, but at least we can discuss them and think about them. So the very natural first one to look at is nutrition. So is it the case that there was a nutrition-based poverty trap? And you do look at these people, like many people in India, are very, very skinny. So it is possible that at prima facie makes a little bit of sense. But then when you look at their, the food consumption, the increase in consumption that we're getting from the household is 15% on average, and it's 17% for food, so not very different. Likewise, within that increase in consumption budget, what you do see increase is not the staple or the cheaper calorie, it's basically the most expensive calorie. So you see people shifting from very cheap calorie to more expensive calories. So even though we didn't do the calculation, it's not entirely clear that the caloric increase really increased from the extra increase in consumption, rather the bundle change in a way that makes it much more appealing, maybe more nutritious. But all that suggests that they were not starving. Had they been starving, number one, the increase in consumption would have been primarily towards food. Secondly, within the food budget, you would have seen an increase in grains and things like that, not sugar and meat and oil. So that makes it not very likely that food was at the, per se, was at the origin of that. Another possibility is quite constrained. This guy maybe had a great business idea, or maybe they would have loved to buy a cow, but they didn't have the money to do that, and a cow is pretty expensive, so it's a fixed asset, so maybe that's the problem. But we say, well, yes, it's a credit constraint in a way, but remember, the MFI was there. And the MFI whole concept is that they want, they're looking for people to include in groups to be lending to them without collateral. So in some sense, they were credit constrained, as in the MFI wasn't going to lend to them, but not because they didn't have collateral or not because they didn't, there wasn't access. It's because they weren't ready, they didn't have a project and things like that. So that sort of prima facie rules out credit constraint as a coherent explanation for what's going on here. So the third possibility, and I put a perhaps here because I don't have a proof that it's what's going on, but is the idea that what happened here is to some extent better mental health. So we went and spent quite a bit of time discussing with the beneficiary before they became beneficiaries. And these are people who, in many ways, many of them appeared to be very depressed, very in a pretty low, pretty like gloomy. And in fact, when you do ask them index of standard questions about depression, you would feel people, a lot of these people scoring very high on depression index. In fact, many people, a surprisingly large number of people declined to take the program. And that's a bit surprising. Part of it was there was a rumor about the fact that maybe, because when you show up, when Bandan show up to people offering them to give them something for free, people were a bit suspicious, so they were questioning their motives and thinking maybe they were trying to convert them to something, Christianity or Hinduism, I don't exactly know, but so there was that thing. There was that rumor, but on top of that, there was also some people just didn't feel the stamina or energy to take up the program. But among the, when you compare treatment and control households, so accounted for people who took the program, what we see at the end, in the first end line in particular, a very strong impact on self-reported health, even though we have no direct impact on actual health, and a very strong impact on self-reported symptoms, all these questions, standard questions to measure depression. By the second end line, those differences have actually leveled out. So you have the usual happiness treadmill where you know something good happened, you're very happy for a while, and then it goes down, back down again. But in a sense, that's not contradictory with people having been through this boost and like feeling better, able to kind of get started on a circle. So I don't have a proof that it's what's going on here. That's more of a sort of tantalizing example to get us started. And what I want to do in this lecture is to say, do we have, like from other studies, from other work, what do we know about the possible effects of something like that, like of some boost in your hope, in your confidence, or on the contrary, some lack of hope and confidence coming from exogenous effects on how on poverty and whether that could create a poverty trap. So one way to phrase the question is whether we should think of hope as a capability in the sense of the term. That is, think of something that not only has intrinsic value, that it's better to be hopeful than hopeless, but also allows people to realize their potential in other dimensions. to lead to better, so something exactly like health or like education, something which is valuable in its own, but also leads you to realize your potential in other dimensions. So I'm going to proceed in three steps tonight. One is explore this question from the point of view of a purely rational decision maker. So why is it the case that dire perspective can be self-fulfilling and become make the perspective even more dire? The second is abandoning the fully rational idea, so the idea that we decide, you know, completely optimally on everything. Think of whether the very fact of hopelessness can affect our decision-making abilities, whether there is a literature on that tells us that maybe the very fact of lacking hope could affect the way we think and the way we reason and the way we process information in a way that would lead to this poverty trap persistence type of things. And the third angle is what happens in sort of an intermediate situation where people are self-aware but not fully rational. So they have the same, so we'll take as a framework something that that everybody, all of us, sort of suffers from some limitation in our decision making. For example, we may have a present biasness. What happens to a person who has this kind of shortcoming when you plunge them in an environment where bad things can happen and do happen? So that's kind of the game plan for today. So let's go to the first part of what, from a point of view, can hopelessness be self-fulfilling from a rational expectation kind of view? So let's go back to the idea of a nutrition-based poverty trap and suppose that you take a very poor person who is on the wrong side of the poverty trap, on the left side. They know that they will never be able to have a good nutritional status because they are on the wrong side anyway, so they know that they are swimming upstream. And suppose that some opportunity comes up, like some, you know, they find $100 or 100 rupees bill. It shouldn't be a too big a bill, but a small bill on the sidewalk, and they are wondering what to do with it. Well, they might decide not to maximize physical fitness because if it's not enough to put them on the other side of the framework, then, you know, what's the point? Like, they're anyway, if they take this money and they eat it in the most efficient way possible, they solve the Stigler problem and they get, like, the most disgusting diet that makes you the most, like, fit, they'll become a little bit fitter and then they will slide back anyway. Then what's the point? Like, to the extent there is anything else you're maximizing in terms of your happiness or you like, you know, to taste good things, and you don't think that you will be able to cross the threshold, then you don't. If instead you anticipated that one time or two times of progressive investment would eventually allow you to cross the threshold, for example, because you anticipate that the wages are expected to go up in the future, loosening the poverty trap set up, or you expect that some transfer might come up and stay, then you might say, well, it's worth eating up that money. So you might start eating a lot, and therefore you would get out of poverty faster than this direct effect would suggest. So the anticipation of future poverty and exacerbate poverty in this framework. That doesn't mean it makes welfare worse because people have made their decisions, but it will exacerbate poverty and low nutrition. So the same logic applies to any situation where there is a threshold to cross before a particular investment becomes profitable. So for example, the minimum scale for a business, if indeed there are jumps in the production function, and you know that you're not going to get a loan that is big enough to bump you over this jump, then there is not much point optimizing every business decision, and particularly if you have other things you want to worry about. So for example, you're a woman who just got a microcredit loan to start a little business. You also have a family, so it's really something you're doing on the side. And you know that the loan is going to be capped at some level that will never make the business very meaningful, then you're not going to be fully invested in the business, neither emotionally, in terms of how well you're thinking every single decision, So you might not get the cheaper input. If you have a store, you might buy exactly the same set of goods as the other store, because that's what they have, even though that's sort of not the most productive. Or you might not have change. You might not make the effort of keeping change. You might not store phone cards, even though they are both cheap and take very little shelf volume. So in this way, you might make sales. All sorts of puzzles that people have sort of found along the way, which are not really puzzles once you realize that people are doing this without being fully invested in it. And it's rational from a point of view of someone who has other things to do, keeping in mind that even being fully invested is not going to make you rich now. In fact, what would be irrational here is to be over-invested in the business, because then it means you would sacrifice other dimensions of your life, of your home life. This is what Charrott's book on optimism bias, or Kahneman, part of Kahneman's recent book of that as well, showing that indeed the irrational people are the entrepreneurs who exhibit this optimism bias and who think they are better than they are. And most of them fail, but then some of them do succeed. But on average, it was a bad deal. So that's something which is both rational, but of course will keep the business small. Where we see evidence of that, for example, is when you try to do business training, which is something that microfinance organization loves to do now, try to provide business training, by and large, the effect of this program has been very, very low. So after you train for weeks someone, they are able to regurgitate the lessons, but you don't see really a change in their management or their profit or anything. What seems to make a difference is very basic lectures, like very basic rule of thumb kind of things, where there you'd think that people do adopt them because they simplify their life instead of adopting them because that's going to make their profit higher. And even though they understand the lessons from the business training, they just rationally maybe decide that it's not worth applying them. So I think we went through this already. So symmetrically, as the lack of hope will lead you to not really fully invest in the business, the fear of loss, which is the reverse of the lack of hope, may lead to very conservative behavior. So for example, way back a few years ago, many years ago already, Jonathan Mordack introduced this idea of income smoothing, saying that you are not going to introduce a new technology because you fear of losing everything. And I know that there is work going on here looking at the effect of insurance on your willingness to adopt a new technology, thinking that maybe you will not hit the insurance allows you to not hit the state of the world where you would actually lose everything because you've implemented that technology. So you have, normal state of being is that you're running, say, like farmers in Kenya I've worked with, use fertilizer, you don't use fertilizer or hybrid seeds. And there are many reasons why it's not the case, but one of the reasons might be that if you plant hybrid seeds and they don't work out, you really have nothing left. And you've spent money to put them in the ground. And even if the take into account in a standard model of risk aversion, the increase in mean plus the increase in risk would make it possible, you would still, you see people just holding back to avoid, to really cut the worst branch of the tree. Example of that is people what you see in many poor countries is people leaving the countryside to go to the city for a short period of time, but not moving their entire family, therefore never really having a career in the city. So people go in construction, for example, in India, in Indonesia, etc. People move to the city to help in construction, but they go for a few weeks for a project, and then they come back, and then they go for a few weeks again, and then they come back. That means that they never become really good at anything. So they never acquire the skills that would make them good construction worker. And one of the rationale that they give, and that's modeled in the Banerjee and Newman paper, is the idea that if you do move completely, you lose access to the insurance network, the social insurance network, informal social insurance network, that help you cut out the worst part of the tree. So again, the fear that something, what happens if I'm sick? Well, if you've cut the link with the countryside, you're really in a pickle. So the fact that the fear that something like that might happen will lead you to hold back and not go completely. You might go a little bit and come back again, go a little bit and come back again, and therefore you stay poor. So this has a direct cost, which can be priced. An early example of trying to price it is Rosenzweig and Wolpin, looking at how much people, you know, estimating a structural model of farm production, showing, looking at, and trying to estimate from that if you could reduce the variability of rainfall by one standard deviation, how much richer would people be from the fact that their investment decision would be closer to optimal. In a model where, in the absence of insurance, people are refraining from some relatively risky investment. So that's one thing. We can calculate that. It's not a huge number in their model, but it's significant. But I think what's much more important is, and where you see that happen, is the lack of self-discovery, and which we, you know, even pricing that is very difficult. So for example, taking back this example of the construction worker, if you don't fully throw yourself in the career of being a construction worker, how do you know that you could have been good at it? Or if you run a business, you start to sew like with your sewing machine, but you never really get very invested in it, how do you know that where you could start a little empire of sewing machine? You really need to be able to fully go into something to understand whether you're good at it. A particularly strong and sad example is the case of education. In many developing countries, I've looked at that in detail in India, in Morocco, in Kenya. The entire system is somewhat elite biased. So the entire system is trying to reach the smartest, quote unquote, kids in the class and to teach them. So you have a class of 80 first graders. The teacher which are very heterogeneous level. The teacher will have to make a choice of where they target their level of instruction. And for the most part, what seems to really rationalize the data we observe is that the teacher focused on the top of the class. Part of that is for historical reason, colonial systems were like that, etc. But part of it is because parents also believe that the returns to education are very convex. In the log space, increasing education from 10 to 11 years has a larger proportional increase on income than increasing from 1 to 2. So in fact, that doesn't appear to be the case. For all we know, it seems to be pretty linear, log linear. But parents seem to believe, when you ask them about their perception of returns to education, very, very convex. For example, in Morocco, people tell us that the return to primary education is zero, that there is no value in primary education, but on the other hand, it's 15% a year for middle school and high school. So hugely convex. That means that that creates a threshold. It doesn't really exist, but it's there in people's perception, and that investing a little bit in education is not optimal. You either want to go all the way or not at all. And what you seem to think, so the implication of that, one empirical consequence of that, is you should see people discriminating between their children towards the smart kid. And they do that. There is evidence, for example, from Burkina Faso that if your brother's IQ is high, that's bad for your own education. And another example that's even striking, a paper by Marianne Bertrand and Lee Linden, where they had a conditional cash transfer which was assigned by lottery at the individual level. So some people lose the lottery in the same family. The kids who won the lottery get more education over and above the requirement of the conditional cash transfer. That's fine. But the people who lose the lottery, and it's a lottery, get less education. So parents going all over the kid who, even though there is more money in the family, so you would think the direct effect should go in this way. So all of this is evidence that investment education seem to be inequality enhancing, which is consistent to this level. So what does this mean? This means that you take a child who is from a poor family, arrives in school, his parents think he is stupid, the teacher thinks he is stupid, Probably he has no opinion at the beginning, but once he has been told often enough that he is stupid, he gets, you know, it's like they must know. No one invests in him, including himself, and it's self-fulfilling. This kid is never going to go anywhere. And that kid could possibly have been just as good. This goes back, you might remember this experiment, the old psychology experiment that wouldn't get IRB approval today, of telling teachers at the beginning of the year that some kids have higher IQ, even though they didn't. And at the end of the year, those higher IQ kids having higher IQ. We see that experiment on a huge scale in many developing countries today. So in this sense, that's hope works as an enabling capability. We need hope to sort of get going in education. It's also, as this example suggests, is essential to the development of further capabilities, for example, education. So I gave you pretty negative examples of people sort of getting depressed, but we see it positively as well. In all of India now, here's a positive example. In all of India now, they're giving their reservations for women at the local level in politics. So they need to, for each local election, which takes place every 5 years, 1/3 of all the places need to elect a woman. They do it randomly, which allows to compare what they did in both places, and they've done it for a while, because the constitutional amendment where this was put in place is from 1993. So we can start seeing the effects not only on public goods and things like that, but also on other things, whether it changes attitude. So one thing we did with Laura Beeman, Roini Pandey, and others is looking at the aspirations of children, of teenagers, and their parents for themselves. So what do you want as a career? How much education do you want? What do you want as a career for your teenage girl or boy? And what we find is a huge gender gap in aspiration of parents for their children. So where parents want their boys to have a career and to be educated for a long time and not their girl. Fine. More interestingly, a very strong, when a woman has been in place for enough years, a very strong reduction in that gap. Not coming from the boys going down, but coming from the girls going up to the boys. So that's one thing. So it did seem to, seeing a woman in action, seeing a woman in power, seemed to change the aspiration of the girls and their parents. This woman happened to have absolutely no control over the education resources, which is a state subject. And despite that, it does change the education and attainment of teenage girls. So that is most likely coming directly from this aspiration effect. So the hope works in order to increase the level of education. Likewise, when there is something that increases the visibility of what can girls do, etc., for example, when back office processing operation come to town, you see people investing more in their girls, you see people investing more and leaving them in school further, when there is a chance that they can do something. So this was kind of step one. You can see, in a purely rational world, you would see a mechanism the only thing that's not purely rational here is this idea that returns to education are convex when, in fact, they seem to be nicely log-linear. So far, we've seen how the lack of perspective may change what people decide. Assuming that we all decide in the same way, our decision process in the same way, we would make the same decision. So we can go further, we can ask whether it also changes how we decide, whether the hopelessness, stress, etc., changes how we decide. And so one of the things it does is that it takes away some time. We don't have that much time, and therefore it just leaves less time to think about the important thing in life. So that's one thing. But there is also a literature at the border between economics and neuroscience that looks at how the biological mechanism behind a possible relationship between stress and decision-making ability. That's a very young literature. So a lot of what I'm going to say is kind of in infancy, might not be very policy relevant, might also be wrong, but I think it's worth kind of putting it on the table, at least suggesting that there is, I think there is a lot of work to be there. So one is, of course, there is a very strong correlation between depression and poverty. That's not particularly surprising. There are several mechanisms for that. One is poor people tend to live in a very stressful environment where they are subject to all sorts of, you know, here in the US, subject to crime, and in developing countries, subject to all these weather shocks. So when you take the people in the moving to opportunity experiment here in the US, they were moved to richer neighborhood. That didn't make them any richer, but that made them less stressed out. There's also a lack of basic infrastructure when you're poor. So we did an experiment in Morocco where we gave people who we worked with a water utility company to give people access to a credit so that they could finance a connection to the grid, to the water grid. And these are guys who already had access to the clean water, but they had to walk towards the plug. It's an urban environment, so not a very long walk. So this experiment had no impact on real access to clean water because they already had access to clean water. Therefore, it had no impact on health. But it freed some time. And the main effect, it seemed to have made people really, really happy because they didn't have to be stressed out anymore about when they are going to get the water and fight with the neighbors and things like that. So another and the last thing, which is the one I want to spend a little bit of more time here, is this idea that worrying about the future, about the fact of being poor means you are subject to more risk, and that makes you worry about the future, and that makes you depressed and sad. So Johannes Haushofer, who is a postdoc at JPL, has this paper where he shows that you take households in Kenya that are living in quite similar circumstances. Those who were hit by water shocks, so you measure them here. The harvest will take place here, so it hasn't taken place yet, and the water shock is here. And then you look at them again right after water shock, but before the harvest. So they aren't poor. They are not poorer yet. But they can anticipate that they are going to be poorer. And you see them, their stress level really increasing. So what does that mean? And can this lead to a vicious circle of depression and shocks? So there is this old sort of literature in psychology dating back to Seligman, who was doing these experiments with dogs, putting them, shocking dogs with shocking dogs with electric shocks and putting them in situation, and then stopping to do that. And the dogs who had received the first shocks were very, very, very worried that they are going to be attacked again, and therefore they were like kind of withdrawn and depressed. So that led Seligman to develop this idea of self-fulfilling stress shock. He called it a pessimistic explanatory style. So it's the idea that if you've received shock in the past, you take two people, one who was lucky in the past, one who was unlucky in the past. The person who was unlucky will think that they might be unlucky again in the future, and their interpretation of the same event will be completely different. So someone who has been subject to shocks in the past will think in response to some data that, oh, that must be bad, and it must be something that I can't really deal with. Whereas someone who had a good experience in the past will see the same data and think, this is something I can probably control. So that means that the person who was unlucky will be less resilient in the face of the future events. Therefore, they will be more likely to have a difficult time, and therefore they will increase their pessimistic style, and therefore they will become more unhappy, etc. So the more negative shocks you suffer, the more pessimistic you become, which makes you even more likely to try to avoid the shocks and avoid the risk, and that creates this vicious circle where you're more and more conservative and more withdrawn, and therefore more and more actually hit by the, unable to resist to the shocks. So that's one possible explanation, just on the sort of psychological, purely psychological explanation. There is something as well which is more biological, which is stress. When you're stressed out, it's usually because there is a reason you need to go away very quickly. So your body is creating, is sending some hormones to help you deal with that. In particular, when you're stressed out, you produce more cortisol. That's in fact the way that we can measure the level of stress in someone. The cortisol is generally something which is good for us. It helps us deal with the stress, but it has some side effects, which is it affects the prefrontal cortex, amygdala and hippocampus functioning, and those are involved in decisions about, for example, the present versus the future. Those are involved into our ability to process and compute things, etc. So this is something that, so there is several things in what I said that we need to take in steps. First of all is what you can do in the laboratory is to stress people out. And then measure how much cortisol they produce, and then see whether they make decisions that seem economically less rational. So the experiment here was an experiment where people start with some, they have to do some rather boring task, and then they accumulate money as part of this boring task in the laboratory. I don't remember what the task was, something like counting dots. So they do that for a while, that's boring and unpleasant. Then some of them get shocked into losing all of the money that they had accumulated with the points. So they're told, oh, sorry, the money got erased. They're told in advance that this might happen, but for some people it does happen, the money got erased. Their wealth, their actual wealth is actually the same because the people whose money you erase, you first has given them a larger gift to get started. So they have the same amount of money, but in some cases, they just, you know, they keep their hard-earned money, and in some cases, they got a big shock. And then you ask them to do this incentivized time choice decisions between today and tomorrow, etc. The people who just got the negative shock appear to be much more present past. One possibility is that they just got mad at the experimenter and then answer in any sort of sense, saying, this is stupid, I don't even want to think about this thing, I want to be out of here. But this is tantalizing that there might be something interesting. So you have here the entire link. And it is the case that they do, when you measure their cortisol, the people who got shocked, they have higher cortisol level. There is less field evidence that stress increases cortisol. But there are two interesting studies. One is the children of the parents who got the Progressa program have lower cortisol level. Which is linked to less depression, less stress in their mothers. And the second is the same people that were subject to the negative shocks, rainfall shocks that I was talking about a slide ago, when you measure their cortisol, they have lower cortisol level. So there could be more, there is a need for more work here, both on whether this actually holds up, whether this holds up with more permanent. Because this all responds to shock, but do people habituate to poverty in a way that really wouldn't make a difference anymore? It's also, there is very little work about directly what's the effect of cortisol on decision-making, except through the experiment I gave you. It turns out cortisol can be manipulated by giving people drugs. So there are some studies in the lab going on today trying to look at that, but the results are not out yet. More generally, it's unclear what this all means too for policy. Does this mean that you should treat people for depression by moving poor people out of poverty? Or should you make people rich by giving them Prozac? Or some? This is something that there is no, so far there is no, I have no, I make no such pronouncement. So this is very new. And maybe it's all bad, but it provides a micro foundation for a possibility based on a poverty trap based on shattered hope, which is a very different mechanism than what I spoke about in the first part about the rational decision making. This is something about the decision making process itself is affected by the condition in which you live. In this case, there would be huge efficiency gain potentially in trying to remove risk from people's life, over and above what has already been discussed in the literature. So in the first part, we showed that considering the future may lead you to a rational response to hold back, which would have consequences. In the second part, we showed that depression could affect your very ability to think about this future in a rational way. And the third possibility is that you could choose to avoid talking about the future precisely because it's bleak, that you don't like to look, if your future doesn't look good, it's something you don't like to contemplate. So let's spend a little bit of time. That might be a way of protecting your sanity. Maybe that's really what you need. If things looking ahead are not good, then you're going to prevent yourself from having to look at it. However, this may prevent or affect important decisions about the future. So for example, people may not think about buying health insurance because they don't like to think about adverse health events, or they may not like to buy burial insurance because they don't like to think about being dead. In this paper, Swan et al., I was involved in that paper. It's a paper on looking at a series of studies. Looking at people from a group were given a baseline for a health insurance program. So at the part of this baseline, they were the guys who got the baseline, they had to answer so many questions about their poor health. And then you can use administrative data to compare the take-up of the insurance among people who were surveyed for the baseline and people who didn't. So that was not intentional, but that created an experiment within the experiment. And what you see is people who are surveyed about their health are much more likely, not much more, but are somewhat more likely to purchase the health insurance. So forcing people to contemplate the bad event has led to more insurance provision. So in public health, that's something which they spend a lot of time on, is how to get people to agree to contemplate something unpleasant. So when things are, when there is something, so there is in particular the distinction between a loss frame message and a gain frame message. So a loss frame message is if you don't do so and so, you'll die. A gain frame is if you do so and so, you will avoid dying. And the loss frame messages are much more effective to encourage behavior like detection, which are sort of supposedly risky behavior. The gain frame behavior are more effective at encouraging concrete prevention actions. So if people see the future in this very bleak way, they might not be able to take the regular prevention action that they would otherwise have taken. Those who risk suffering the most negative shock in the future, so those are the poor who are not insured and things like that for which the consequence will be large, are maybe the ones who are not willing to spend a lot of time thinking about it. So number one, they don't have time thinking about it because they are dealing with urgent things today. Number two, they might really not want to because it really doesn't look as good, and therefore you might spend less time taking steps that are going to prevent you from these very shocks. So one example of that is going back to this migration work. So I already told you that people tend to migrate temporarily, and you don't have as much permanent migration as you might perhaps expect. But in fact, the puzzle of low migration goes further than that. There's a lovely paper by Garrett Bryan. I realize I don't know this person's first name, and Mushfiq Mubarak. Where they look at Bangladesh. In Bangladesh, in the hungry season, people are literally hungry, very poor. They provide them $8 for the bus fare to go to the city. When they do that, and that's randomized across people, so the first thing you can do is to compare how much, so you get some amount, a number of people are induced by these $8 to migrate. And you can use that to estimate the economic returns to migration. And the return to migration for those who migrate are $100 extra consumption for the family against the $8 bus fare. So you would think, well, more people should migrate. More people should do this temporary migration during the hungry season. But in fact, very few people migrate. And even with the incentive, only 22% percentage point more people migrate. And even among those who have gone once, about half of the people go again. So why are they not going to the city? Why do they stay home near starvation when there is this $100 to be had? So you could say, well, this is this risk aversion. You know, they might fail, and what if they spend the $8 and nothing happens? But the risk aversion has to be really, really high for it to be worth it. So one possibility is not so much risk aversion as loss aversion. You are very poor, but you really don't want to be any poorer than what you are today. So if you're in addition, you're pessimistic in this case, you're pessimistic about the possibility that anything can change in a drastic way, then that can make you extremely conservative. So if you knew that, if you were hopeful about what the city could bring to you, then you might be thinking, okay, it's worth taking the trade-off of this. I'm loss averse. I don't want to take the risk of losing $8, but that might still be worthwhile because the benefits might be so high. But if you don't know, or you underestimate it, or you might not be willing to make the move. And what they show is that when they insure these people ex ante, when they provide insurance for these people ex ante about their earnings in the city, then people are much more likely to go than even if they don't get the $8 bus transfer. So that might be something going on, which is you just don't have the loss aversion is itself coming from the fact that you underestimate how brighter the perspective are in the city. The last topic I want to touch on is this idea that you can become pessimistic, is that being pessimistic about yourself might also lead you to act in ways that are going to further your poverty. Because people are not only pessimistic about the world around them, they're also pessimistic about their own ability to stick to plans. They are pessimistic about their ability to in particular, to stick to resolutions that they are making today about the future. So we are all subject to temptations. We all know that an ice cream today looks particularly tempting, we would enjoy it today, but when we're thinking about that same ice cream in the future, we really derive no particular enjoyment of considering that ice cream in the future. So these are temptation goods of that form. So we are all subject to temptation, and to some extent you know it. That's why we take some steps to say, you take subscription to the gyms, or you put your money, you have some money locked up in a 401k or things like that to try to fight against our own temptation. So we are subject to this temptation. We are the richer people, and we are self-aware about them. The question is, if you don't have access to these technologies that allows you to fight against your temptation, is the self-awareness something that is going to help you, or is it going to hurt you? Is being self-aware about yourself, so realizing that in the future you're not going to be such a good person, does it make you more apt to get over it today, or does it make you less apt to get over it today? And Banerjee and Melanchthon have a paper which shows that it crucially depends on how rich or poor you are. So consider, for example, being quite poor and wanting a television, but you don't have enough money to buy the television, so you need to save some amount towards the television. And the television is not a temptation good in this model, it's something that you'll really enjoy having for the future. So saving towards the television is painful today because you have to deny yourself a temptation good that you might like. Now, because you're self-aware, you do know you're not very hopeful about yourself. You do know that tomorrow you may squander the money that you've saved today. And you don't. So you're anticipating tomorrow eating this ice cream instead of with the money that you saved today. Of course, you have no enjoyment thinking about today because you don't. The temptation good is such that it's something you like to consume today, but you don't look forward to it in the future. So why bother? The only reason to bother is to think whether or not this is, what is going to be stronger? Is it going to be the temptation tomorrow, or is it going to be the fact that the television is one step further? And what they show is that if temptation goods are such that we are relatively quickly satiated, so for example, it's sweet tea or Coca-Cola or sweets or things like that, where, you know, there's only so much we can eat, while the goods we to look forward to are more expensive, like a television, then this can be the source of a poverty trap based on saving. Because if you're rich enough, you're saving a little today, it's not as painful because you can afford the little bit of ice cream you'd like and to put some money aside. And in addition, you know that tomorrow the same thing will be true again, and therefore you will put the money today and you will keep it tomorrow. If you're poorer, you need about the same amount of ice cream to feel happy with the ice cream consumption, but then no money is left for saving. And you also know that the same will be true tomorrow, or the saving would be very costly today, then you wouldn't have the ice cream, but you know that tomorrow you will be tempted to again take the ice cream. So a poor person will save less and less because of that self-awareness, whereas if you reach enough above some threshold, you cross the system. So that creates a poverty trap very much like the with the same logic of the nutrition-based poverty trap, where above some threshold you save more and more and become rich, and accumulate. Below the threshold, you will decide not to save. So in that case, it's your hopelessness about yourself. So our, not only our imperfections that we all have, but our knowledge about this imperfection that brings the poverty traps. So that leads us to this idea that in principle, a lot of people, when I discuss, particularly say undergraduate, when we discuss saving, say, of course the poor don't save. They are so poor, they don't have any money left. Which per se doesn't make any sense, because if you're poor today and poor tomorrow, you have no money today and you have no money tomorrow, so that there is no less reason to save. But here in this model, we see that the savings crucially depend on your perspective of the future. People who feel that they may be close, that their dreams are within reach, have reasons to cut frivolous consumption and save, but those who have nothing to gain, really, will tend to make decisions that reflect these desperations. And that creates difference between rich and poor, and that also even creates difference between poor people, again, based on the history of that you've experienced in the future. So, for example, when microcredit becomes available, you now know that you have the ability to buy the television by taking a loan to get the microcredit. You may or may not do it now, but you know that it's possible. You'll have to pay for it in some ways, but you can buy the television on credit. One way to get a television that was not available to you before, since you were not savings because you know you were going to take it out, now you can borrow to get the television, and the credit officer is going to act as this extraneous force that is going to force you to repay towards your television. So you might have been just as happy to wait towards the television. You're not in a very, very big hurry to get it. But if you had to rely on your own savings to get it, you would never have gotten it. But now that you can rely on an external person to come and bug you to get the money, you're able to get going. So that creates this difference between poor people depending on the access they have to different technologies. So let me conclude, and then we can open for questions. I've tried to demonstrate that hope can operate as a capability. A little bit of hope allows people to realize their potential by getting them started for doing their own bit in this effort. Hopelessness destroys both the will and the ability, in some sense, to invest in one's future and in oneself and potentially in one's own children, like we saw for the case of education. So what are the policy implications? The first one is that there is potentially huge values in policies that remove the worst branches of the tree. So in addition from the classic example, classic reason for why you might want insurance, that might be a reason to want insurance. Or for that matter, a minimum income that serves as a floor would work just as well. Or protection against health catastrophes, so that the worst possibilities are removed. The second thing that it implies is that you want to make people aware of the opportunities and possibilities in order to affect aspirations. So that's what we saw with the woman. as policymakers, providing a clear example of what's possible, that you're not trapped, that your girl is not trapped in this particular life. There are options for her. And the third one, which is a little bit related, is that anything that can help make the goalpost closer rather than further will help. So in education, the movement in a lot of developing countries, for example in India today, is to remove all the exams until grade 10. And that's kind of completely silly. You wouldn't, in this particular world, you would want to go exactly in the other direction, which you would want to have very regular benchmark of saying, this is what you achieved till now, this is what you're getting for that, etc., as opposed to setting up a benchmark grade 10 years and years from now that you know for the most part you're not, or you believe, but often wrongly, that your kid's not going to be able to get there anyway. So let me stop here, so that we leave some time for questions.
And Professor Duflo, that was a very inspirational lecture, and we appreciate you coming out to Sacramento Valley. And we can't send you home without some agricultural products in the Sacramento Valley. So.
Thank you very much.